We become what we think about. One of my favorite audio programs that I've been listening to over and over again since 2007, because any book or any audio that is really deep, you can listen to over and over again and apply the principles learned within, and then come back to the book or come back to the audio, revisit it, and pull out even more distinctions and elements that you didn't pick up the first time that is only revealed to you after taking action, after applying. This is the process of studying. It is not about the abundance of information. It is about the quality and the depth and the understanding that at every moment, with all information, with all people, with all environment, with all circumstance, you have access to the acres of diamonds. Everything that you ever want in life is available to you right now. It has always been available to you at all time. The question is, do you see it? Do you value it? Now, the truth is this, we could always value things more. So if someone gets to a certain level where they value what they have, we have to remember that that is just the beginning. We can always value it more. Now, what am I sharing with you? This is a way of thinking. It is a way of thinking that has helped me throughout this journey. It is a way of thinking that I would like to infuse in you, and it is a way of thinking that I want to continue to infuse in myself. And the thinking is that the thoughts are the seedlings that generate the feelings, the actions, the people, the environment, the circumstance, the experiences, the external world is a net result of thinking. What is in the imagination? What is in your mind? You receive what is in your mind from two primary sources. One we call the five senses, which is the external world, the planet Earth, the information that we take in. We are the five senses, programs what we have in our mind, our inner conversations, that what we imagine, that what we think about. What we think about is impressed on the subconscious mind, and the subconscious mind has a responsibility to bring forth. When you become a conscious creator, you start to guard and protect and nurture what goes into your subconscious mind, and you feed your subconscious mind with exactly that what you want to see brought forth, because it's your subconscious mind that brings it forth. The other source is through the sixth sense. The cultivation and development of the sixth sense is found through a certain level of understanding of the principles of how reality works on Earth. We are here to learn how to become creators because we were created in the image of the Creator, and we are to move on in this life, creating through exercise that what you receive as a vision to bring it forth and to graduate into bringing more of your vision forth until you are done this life, and then you move on and you live into a different life, continuing what you take as far as understanding of this life into the next life. You are an immortal being having a human experience right now. Now, this may sound like a far out statement, but I promise you this. The more you take action and actually create that what you desire, pick a goal, pick a definite chief aim, use your mind to create it, the more it will be revealed to you of how the universe works, how the sixth sense works. You'll begin to understand the power of God more. But the bottom line is this, we can simplify this. You can look at the thoughts that you have right now, and you can realize and understand and reflect that the reality that we are experiencing is a net result of the thinking that either came from our five senses or our intuition within, but it's what we have been nurturing and encouraging in our mind that we continuously express via the subconscious mind to create. So what I've done is I've taken quotes from Earl Nightingale, who shared The Strangest Secret, which is the audio I still listen to over and over again, and Neville Goddard and James Allen, who I also believe to be masters of thinking, masters of thought, masters of the mind, to discuss this very important element that we become what we think about. Now, I have in this video key distinctions that I have pulled, and we're going to go through them. There's 21 of them that are my own distinctions that I have found in my journey of uncovering and realizing the power of my mind. And you have the ability to uncover your own distinctions and incorporate my distinctions if they feel right for you, to tap into your ability to become the creator that you are destined to become. Earl Nightingale said, "Throughout history, the great wise men, teachers, and philosophers, and prophets have disagreed with one another on many different things. It is only on this one point that they are complete and unanimous agreement. And the key to success and the key to failure is this: we become what we think about." So just about any kind of text, any kind of spiritual text or philosopher will reveal to you the essence of our teaching is the way of thinking. The philosophy creates the reality. It is our values and beliefs. It is how we believe reality to work that is expressed outwards. In the Bible, it said, "As you believe, so it shall be done unto you." So here are some distinctions. Repetition of the same information from multiple perspectives creates absolute conviction and faith in the thought. So we become what we think about. There are countless philosophers and prophets and wise people out there that say the same thing, and it's important to consume the same information from multiple different sources sharing their own perspectives that reveal the same thing. Why? Because that's how you form different connections in the brain. That's how you develop absolute faith and conviction. And once you have a certain degree of absolute faith and conviction, you begin to honor and trust that you have the power within to attract the resources, to take the optimal actions, to modify certain kinds of behaviors that are not in alignment that you see manifest from you within by changing your thinking, and have the confidence and faith to honor that and infuse your subconscious mind with related information till that is brought forth. And if your conviction is not there when it comes to the power of the thought, it's important to consume information with repetition again and again to program the mind to realize that the power is within. It is when you realize that the power is within that you have access to the power within. If you don't believe it's possible, you will not have access to it. If the information you consume is contrarian to the truth that the power is within, then you will not have the power within. And maybe sometimes you will express it randomly, but what we want to do is express it consciously. Number two, the net result of varied thinking on the same topic creates varied results cross-referenced back to thought. So you got many different people that talk about different philosophies and ways of living life. You can evaluate their philosophies, and you can track the results that they have in their life, and you can relate it back to their thought, their own version of it. Do this with anybody. It's actually a very important study to study the various people that cross your path. Look at the current circumstance of their life, and then observe the words that they use, the statements that they make, the conversations that they have with themselves and others, how they believe reality to work, and reference that back to the reality that they have created. And you will see that it was easily able to be referenced once you understand that there's a connection, a clear connection between the thought and the results. So varied thinking, everybody's got varied thinking, and we've got varied results. The results are either harmonious or inharmonious, which reveals harmonious or inharmonious thoughts. Number three, thought is learned from the five senses of past experiences and also the sixth sense. So we live in this world where consciousness keeps increasing. For many years, we lived in a fear-based reality because we thought that that was the only way to create success, results, to create what we want, by taking away from another person or fear-based thinking. And as consciousness rises and we begin to work more with the power within, we let go of the need to control because we find that we're still able to create what we want without the need for control. So this is where we get into unconditional love. Now, we can learn from the external world empowering thoughts, empowering ways of looking at reality, or we could learn via the five senses, which is the external world, disempowering thoughts. Now, the net result of what we assume and what we believe to be as fact, the meaning we give, whether it be empowering or disempowering, will go into the subconscious mind and the subconscious mind will express accordingly. Disempowering thoughts will be expressed as disempowering experiences through people, environment, and circumstance. Empowering thoughts will be experienced because it impresses on the subconscious mind, taken in via the five senses of meaning. It will be expressed outwards as empowering people, environment, and circumstance and opportunity. We have the choices. Now, I also said the sixth sense. The sixth sense is infinite intelligence. It is the superconscious mind. It is the source that created the five senses and created everything. So it has the knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, and the voice within reveals it to you. It is the voice that is there every time when you're about to make a decision and you know if it's the right decision or not, and you choose whether you honor that decision or not. It is the voice from within, and it speaks a voice of empowerment. It gives you the ability to override the programming that has been taken in via the five senses and impressed in the subconscious mind. So how does one experience this? Perhaps at a certain stage in their life, they realize that the way that they were living was a lie. It wasn't really who they truly are. If you haven't watched my video, when I talk about how imagination is the vision, or the imagination is the identity, or the vision is the identity, whatever way you want to look at it, I refer to the Robert Dilts model. In the Robert Dilts model, you got multiple layers. On the top, you've got vision, then you've got identity, then you've got values and beliefs, you've got capabilities, behaviors, and environment. The goal is to make the identity in alignment with the vision. When the identity, inner identity, self-image within, is congruent to the vision, the capabilities, the behaviors, the environments, and the values and beliefs are also congruent and expressed, and you have a congruent person who's able to create the vision in the environment, brought forth through congruence. If there's inharmony, then there's something going on with the identity. And what we have to do is change the identity around. Now, in that video, I mentioned that the soul wants to express itself. So as your consciousness rises, as you raise up in your ability to become more like the creator, you begin to receive hunches and inspirations via your inner voice of what you truly want to create in life. And that is your gift, and that is yours. And it is then your responsibility to use the power of your mind to bring it forth, that via your definite chief aim. If you haven't watched the video I did on definite chief aim, I recommend you watch it. I'll put a link in the description. When you bring that vision forth, when you bring that definite chief aim forth, you start to trust that inner voice more. So you always had the connection to the inner voice. We always had the connection to the sixth sense. The question is, do we honor it? Most of us live through the information that we take in via the five senses, and we rely upon that information, failing to realize that there's a voice within, there's a world within, and that is the sixth sense. I believe that 1% of what exists is via the five senses, and 99% is via the six senses. But a lot of times we assume that all that exists is that what can be interpreted via the five senses. And what we want to do is interpret via the sixth sense, which may seem a little esoteric and far out to somebody who has not taken an idea, an insight that came from the soul, the soul's desire, what the heart truly wants, and express it and create it. Once you do that, you'll begin to tap more into the sixth sense, and you will find meaning within the sixth sense. And then you will be able to express certain kinds of thoughts, ideas, hunches, insights, perspectives through your subconscious, because they will be impressed from within via the sixth sense. The sixth sense will start impressing itself on the subconscious mind, and what you'll start to work with is the creative imagination. Now, creative imagination is something that I talked about in two videos. One video that I did on Napoleon Hill, where he talks about imagination. I'll put a link in the description. And the most recent video, the one I did prior to this, talking about the power of imagination. So working with the creative imagination is working with what Neville Goddard talks about, is the connection with God. God, he says, is the imagination. I believe God is found in the imagination. Whatever way you want to look at it, the imagination creates reality. It is your thoughts. Imagination is a bunch of pictures a lot of times, although we can experience our imagination through varied senses. A picture is worth 1,000 words. These are all thoughts, and these thoughts are brought forth. And each time you receive something that is your soul's expression, your job is to bring it forth, make it a priority. As Steve Jobs said, don't let the noise of others' opinions drown out your own inner voice. Everything else is secondary. There's a reason why. And he was a big fan of Yogananda's work, Self-Realization, which, by the way, I recommend you watch that video I did on Autobiography of the Yogi. But the bottom line is this. You're given an insight from the superconscious. You got the conscious mind, the subconscious mind, the superconscious. Superconscious expresses and communicates with the subconscious if you allow it by releasing fears. When the superconscious reveals to you an insight of what to be brought forth, make it a priority and bring it forth, because it's not just about bringing it forth and producing that success, but it's what happens. You cleanse yourself of fears, doubts, and indecision in the process to receive further hunches and instructions via the subconscious mind through the superconscious. And then you'll start to have your subconscious mind program your subconscious, or your superconscious mind will program the subconscious, and then you will express outwards in very creative expressions, service to others, product, service if you're an entrepreneur, or artistic expressions that will be received really well. But what is really happening is divine is looking to manifest on earth, and this is the process for doing so. As above, so below. A person who is thinking about a concrete and worthwhile goal is going to reach it, because that's what he's thinking about. Conversely, the person who has no goal, who doesn't know where he's going, and whose thoughts must therefore be thoughts of confusion, anxiety, fear, and worry, will thereby create a life of frustration, fear, anxiety, and worry. And if he thinks about nothing, he will become nothing. No matter what you think about, it will be brought forth. You can think about a specific worthwhile goal, and you can think about what is related to that specific worthwhile goal, or you can find yourself thinking about fears, doubts, indecision, anxiety, frustration. It will be brought forth. So, number four, harmonious thoughts of a definite chief aim calibrates further thinking related to the outcome of the definite chief aim. I made a video when I talk about the definite chief aim. I believe it's important to not only have at every point in your life a definite chief aim, which is something that you receive from within, from the soul, to create your true identity. There's the false identity. Again, we talked about that in the identity video. That was assumed to be who you are via the five senses and maybe other people telling you this is how you are. And then there's your true identity, who you are destined to become. Your definite chief aim is given to you via your soul. And that is the genesis of discovering your true identity. You honor it, you bring it forth, and then another vision is revealed to you. You bring that forth over and over again, and then you become who you are destined to be. You feel yourself, you live the life that you are destined to live. So harmonious thoughts of a definite chief aim calibrates further thinking. So when you think about your definite chief aim all day long, you'll start to realize that everything in your life is contributing towards your definite chief aim. All the important areas of your life is contributing towards your definite chief aim. And your definite chief aim is also contributing to all the other important areas of your life. So the goal is to have a definite chief aim and make it a priority to bring forth your definite chief aim, and to have with every moment of your life a gratitude for each moment as the acres of diamonds of opportunity that brings forth or contributes to bring forth the definite chief aim. And it is revealed in your thinking about how you see each person, environment, and circumstance in relation to your definite chief aim. Number five, lack of definite chief aim can lead to a person having indecision, doubt, which crystallizes into fear to project outward and materialize fear into form. What we have impressed in our subconscious mind will express itself outwards via the subconscious mind and materialize into form. And if we allow indecision and doubt into our subconscious mind, there is implications for this. Now, Napoleon Hill talks about this in the chapter Outwitting the Six Ghosts of Fear, where he says that fear is a net result of indecision and doubt being crystallized into fear. So the early stages is indecision. When you start to experience indecision in your life, and you continue to encourage that thought of indecision, what you're not doing is listening to your own inner voice. The answer is found within you. That's why it's important to, when you experience indecision, to come up with a decision to overcome that indecision right away. Because if you don't do that, what will happen is you will experience doubt. And then that doubt will start to take control and power over you. And once it has enough power over you, it will turn into fear. And when fear is impressed in the subconscious mind, it is expressed outward as a fearful representation. You will experience fear in the external world through a person, environment, or circumstance to reveal that what was within you was the impression of fear. That's what it is. And this is found usually through a person that does not have a definite chief aim. Now, I can think about many times in my life where I had a definite chief aim and there was very little fear. And there was a very rapid decisiveness because I have something to cross-reference it to. So that's why we're going to get into number 6 here, which says, a definite chief aim brought forth reveals the true identity of the individual, and a further definite chief aim to reveal further elements of the true identity. So what this means is that the definite chief aim, or having a purpose in life, needs to be a consistent thing. Because if you don't have a definite chief aim, and you have to pick one, just pick something and stick with it till it's brought forth, it is both living a purposeful life, and it's an exercise of cultivation your abilities of mind power. If you don't have that, you leave your mind open for drifting. I recommend watching the discussion that I did on Outwitting the Devil by Napoleon Hill. He talks about a concept called drifting. A person that's drifting has their mind open to all kinds of influences which may or may not bring forth a desired outcome. You leave it up to chance. It's gambling. If you infuse a definite chief aim in the subconscious mind will bring it forth, the exact desire that you want. So why not create a life of what you want? Why not bring forth that what you want? Why would you leave it up to chance? If you leave it up to chance, it's a gamble. You may get the good thing or you may not. But if you don't end up getting the good thing, then there's a further issue that happens. Self-confidence begins to drop. Self-esteem begins to drop. And if that keeps continuing, a person might find themselves in situations that continuously bring forth the undesired. Because the undesired experience further impresses in the subconscious mind. And the subconscious mind has a responsibility to bring forth whatever is impressed in the subconscious mind. That's it. And so what the subconscious mind will then do is bring forth further desired outcomes. That's why having a definite chief aim is very important. And by having a definite chief aim, you can ask yourself a question with every experience that you have in your life. And anytime you are faced with indecision, what can I do right here, right now, that will move me forward towards my definite chief aim? It's about the definite chief aim. What can I do right now? And right then and there, the answer will be revealed within you. It will always be revealed within you because the instruction of the definite chief aim came from the superconscious, and the how is revealed via the superconscious. Try it. Test it out. Next time, First, create a definite chief aim. And next time you experience any indecision, make a statement like this to your subconscious mind. Say, subconscious mind, I realize that you are connected to the source of all knowledge, information via the superconscious, infinite intelligence. You have access to this information. You also are a repository of all experiences that I've had in my life. I'm faced with a decision right now. Give me the exact insight, perspective, hunch on what I need to do, and I will act with calm faith and take that action. And right then and there, give it a few moments, a hunch will show up, an inspiration will show up. And sometimes it might not make any sense, but that's how the subconscious mind works. That's how the superconscious mind works, because I mentioned this earlier. Most of our knowledge and wisdom that exists via the 5 senses is 1%. 99% exists in the 6th sense, so you have to trust whatever is being received via the inner voice is the right thing to do and take action on it and then see what happens. Some way, somehow, it will produce the result. So as I said in number 6 here, a definite chief aim brought forth reveals the true identity of the individual. So why are we here then? We're here to create because we were created in the image of the creator. We're being taught how to create. And the definite chief aim is a step in the right direction. And once you complete it, once you achieve the definite chief aim, you'll realize further powers in the mind. That's why in Think and Grow Rich, he said, The sixth sense can only be understood by understanding the previous philosophies or the previous steps of the philosophy, all those things that were talked about in the Think and Grow Rich video, and I recommend you watch it. I did a 3-hour video on it. By applying the principles, you tap into the connection to infinite intelligence, the sixth sense, and a further definite chief aim is revealed, and the cycle repeats over and over again. The human mind is much like a farmer's land. The land gives the farmer a choice. He may plant in that land whatever he chooses. The land doesn't care what is planted. It is up to the farmer to make the decision. The mind, like the land, will return what you plant, but it doesn't care what you plant. If the farmer plants two seeds, and one is a seed of corn, and the other is nightshade, a deadly poison, waters and takes care of the land, what will happen? Remember, the land doesn't care. It will return poison in just as wonderful abundance as it will corn. So up come the two plants, and one corn, one poison. As it's written in the Bible, as he sow, so shall he reap. Let's look at some distinctions related to that. Number 7, the garden of the mind bears fruit to share as service or contribution, which translates into reciprocity. The garden of the mind. When we cultivate the mind and see it as the garden, we look at information as seedlings that get planted into our mind. And as a result of consuming and encouraging, uplifting, empowering information, and allowing that to impress the subconscious mind, we cultivate a garden that grows and bears fruitful thoughts, ideas, hunches, inspirations, optimizations that allow you to create products, services, helpful ideas to solve problems in the world. And that translates into reciprocity. You will receive that what you put out. This is a net result of what goes into the mind. What goes into the mind gets planted into the mind, and it brings forth, and it also grows and gets encouraged to bring forth fruit that are unique contribution-based elements that you will share with others. And as a result of sharing it with others through your own form of creative expression, be it words, music, arts, invention, you create value in the world. You bring forth well-being in the world. You contribute to consciousness rising in the world, and you will be rewarded accordingly. What you put out as far as value will always come back to you. Number 8, current return is a result of past investment in the mind, which brings forth stories within that express outward into the theater of life. Information that you've taken in via the five senses, wherever you got that information from, is going into your subconscious mind. It is being projected as well in the image of mind, and you are creating stories of possible scenarios that may or may not exist. And if it's disempowering information that is played out in the image of mind as a story, and that story, that visual story of maybe a disempowered outcome, is impressing itself in the subconscious mind, and it will be expressed outward and played outwards in the theater in life through your connections and relations with people, environment, and circumstance, be it positive or negative. So what we have to do is invest in the cultivation of our mind. Remember that past investments may not have been made voluntarily. We have to see the mind as what we put in there as an investment, because it will be brought forth. Those are seeds that are getting planted. But for many of us, until we've come across information like this, we've been allowing the external world to impress our subconscious mind with information, which causes us to create things that we do not desire, which causes us to imagine in our mind stories that we do not want to see brought forth. But when we hold in our imagination those stories, we impress the subconscious mind and they do get brought forth. But now we have a conscious choice. Number 9, the subconscious mind brings forth through the instructions of the five senses or the sixth sense. So the subconscious mind has various ways of bringing forth that what is impressed in the subconscious mind. via the imagination, via the inner conversations, what we say when we talk to ourselves, what we think about, our imagination. It has its own way of bringing it forth. It will utilize the five sensory-based data and meaning and understandings that we have, and it will even tap into the sixth sense to bring it forth. Take an inventory of the various experiences and elements that you have brought forth in your life, and you will find that some things you were able to explain and some things you were not able to explain. Some things happened so miraculously that you could not find an explanation of how it happened. The chain of events was so precise and so unique that was a manifestation of a miracle via the subconscious mind. But regardless, the truth will remain. The subconscious will bring forth. Now we say, as you believe, so it shall be done unto you. So we allow ourselves to believe in the possibility of miracles. Believe in the possibility that the sixth sense will bring it forth in the most harmonious, miraculous way, in the spirit of harmony. Benefit for you, benefit for others, benefit for divine or evolution. And when you believe it to be that way, it will be brought forth that way. So Neville Goddard says, talking to oneself is a habit everyone indulges in. We could no more stop talking to ourselves than we could stop eating and drinking. All that we can do is control the nature and the direction of our inner conversations. Most of us are totally unaware of the fact that our inner conversations are the causes of the circumstances of our life. So we are all imagination that impresses the subconscious mind to express outward, to be experienced via the five senses that was formed in our imagination via our inner conversation. Now, we have inner conversations whether we are aware of our inner conversations or not. We have inner conversations. They are there. Now, as mentioned earlier, the inner conversations that we have is a lot of times based on past programming and impressions in the subconscious mind. And the subconscious mind causes us to have certain kinds of inner conversations as well. We're not consciously saying we want to have those inner conversations if they're disempowering, but it is a net result of what we believe as far as reality, how it works, which is a net result of the thinking that we have assumed to be fact, that we have taken in via the five senses and given meaning to, or someone has told us that this is the meaning. But the bottom line is that information is further impressing the subconscious mind to express outward. And a lot of us are unaware of the inner conversations that we have. We're not aware of how it's happening, how it was infused in there, and now I'm telling you. We also don't know that we are having it because we just kind of go through life autopilot. But if we stop for a moment and reflect on what's going on in our mind, we will find these inner conversations. It's what we say when we talk about ourselves, about others, about people, about circumstance, about environment. And a lot of times we allow the opinions of others, be it empowering or disempowering, to program it. Now, it could be empowering, it could be disempowering, but the question is, what do you want in your subconscious mind? We said that the important thing to remember is the subconscious mind is like a garden, and whatever seeds you plant in the subconscious, it will express and bring forth, and it will grow trees that will bear certain kinds of fruits, trees of knowledge and wisdom, and it can also bring forth trees within the subconscious mind that have poisonous thoughts that will also bring forth. Most of our inner conversations happen unknowingly, programmed by our environment. This is a big revelation. So as mentioned, you could live reality by taking information via the five senses or the sixth sense. The choice is yours. The sixth sense will always give you the empowering meaning, the uplifting understandings. It gives you your vision. It is the source of your vision. It is also the source of the how to bring forth your vision. Now, the five senses also have that. It's just the question is, are we being very aware on the kind of information we're taking in, be it empowering or disempowering, related to our definite achieving? And are we assuming the disempowering information to be fact? Because the disempowering information hinders the progress towards realization of the definite achieving. The key is to be harmonious between the information and the definite chief aim so that it's brought forth, because that gets impressed in the subconscious mind. Those are seeds that get planted. And that is programmed by our environment, the external world. We have the five senses or the sixth sense. So now we have to be more discerning on the information we're taking in via the five senses, because a lot of the information that, or the external world, has been created as a net result of the thinking of yourself and others. So we have to be discerning and say, others have created empowering things and disempowering things. It is not to blame them, because a lot of them don't know what they're doing. That's why in the Bible it said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But what we have to do is say, the empowering information is what we choose to take in. And if they created disempowering information, then that's a net result of what was in their subconscious mind. We're choosing not to take that in. And if you find yourself consuming disempowering information, you can change the meaning of that information. Watch the video I did on mental chemistry. I'll put a link in the description. So number 12, our level of self-esteem causes an attraction to people, environment, circumstance, and information that validates the level of our self-esteem to generate related inner conversations that express outward to be experienced via the five senses. And again, what is expressed outwards is received via the five senses and reprogramming the subconscious mind to recreate it again and again and again. Now, we have to do the work and raise up our level of self-esteem and self-love. I recommend watching the discussion I did on Louise Hay's book, You Can Heal Your Life, as well as The Six Pillars of Self-Esteem by Nathaniel Branden. Doing the self-esteem work changes the identity, evolves the identity, which nurtures certain kinds of thoughts, which encourages certain kinds of thoughts, and causes you to attract the certain kinds of people, environment, and circumstance that affirm those thoughts if you have a high level of self-esteem. If you have a low level of self-esteem, the same is true. He says, we are told that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. But do we know that man's thinking follows the tracks laid down in his own inner conversations? To turn the track to which he is tied in the direction in which he wants to go, he must put off his former conversation, which is called in the Bible the old man, and be renewed in the spirit of the mind. Speech is the image of mind. Therefore, to change his mind, he must first change his speech. By speech, it is meant those mental conversations we carry on with ourselves. So number 13, how we think of ourselves, others, environment, people, and circumstance expresses outward to reveal to ourselves our own inner conversations, and thus thoughts can't be kept secret. As mentioned earlier, a great exercise is to have a conversation with somebody and observe how they believe reality to work through their thoughts and the words, and what they say is a net result of what they experience in their reality. That will give you a great understanding of how thoughts relate to experiences of reality for each person, and give you a deeper understanding about yourself, because then you'll be able to see how your thoughts created the experiences that you have and cross-reference. Make a study of it. Number 14, how we feel about another person is self-personified, fragmented, and expressed out via the subconscious to reveal how we feel about ourselves. It doesn't matter who you think of. Whatever way you think of them, you do onto them and you do onto yourself. And if you think negative about another person, you actually can dig into your thoughts and realize that there's still negative programming within you about yourself. And it's projected into the thought about the other person, but most likely you're doing the same thing. Now, this is not to shame ourselves, but rather understand ourselves. All this is valuable information to our evolution, to realizing and understanding and working with the power of our thought, and creating affirmations that help us understand and value ourselves for revealing to us about ourselves through what is expressed in the external world. This is the harmonious relationship between the conscious mind, the subconscious mind, and the superconscious. Neville says, I rarely see a person alone without wondering to what conversation piece he is tied. On what mysterious track is he walking? So Neville is saying the same thing. He rarely sees a person alone without wondering that. It's important to study what others are revealing to you about how their thoughts are creating their reality. As important is it for you to study yourself and observe your thoughts and see how it is creating your reality. Every moment is an opportunity to reflect and study. And people are your allies to reveal to you the power of thought reflected into form, and vice versa. He says, we must begin to take life consciously. So what am I saying here? This is conscious living. This is not living on autopilot and randomness. This is conscious choosing and impressing the subconscious mind and allowing it to express consciously. Yes, most of what is getting expressed out by the subconscious, you can't consciously think about. But this is the harmonious relationship between the conscious mind and the subconscious mind, is to guard the subconscious mind, to nurture the subconscious mind, and to consciously impress the subconscious mind so that it brings forth that what is harmonious and is related towards the definite chief aim, towards the vision. For the solution of all problems lies just in this. The second man, the Lord from heaven in all of us, is trying to become self-conscious in the body, that he may be about his Father's business. What are his labors? To imitate his Father, to become master of the word, master of his inner talking, that he may be mold this world of ours into likeness with the kingdom of love. So number 15, as above, so below. The divine is looking to manifest through us via a definite chief aim. That is what's happening. And the question is, are we allowing it? If you ask, you shall receive. Ask for the one thing that you can do, the definite chief aim. And follow this process and what we talk about to bring forth the definite chief aim by understanding that the way it will be brought forth will be revealed to you. It is via the power of the subconscious, either through the five senses that the subconscious has accumulated data from, plus the sixth sense, or primarily the sixth sense. That is not up to you to consciously think about. What you are consciously set to do or need to do is to ask for the definite chief aim and to honor the subconscious mind, guard the subconscious mind, and infuse the subconscious mind with empowering information, so that it can do its thing to bring forth that what is related to your true vision, which is fragmented to you in elements called definite chief aim that will be revealed through you all throughout your life, and continues to do that to build a relationship within so that the divine manifests through you. That will create the relationship, a harmonious relationship between the conscious mind, the subconscious mind, and the superconscious mind. Number 16, by changing our inner conversations, we realize that we have far more power to create what we want without the use of force. So as mentioned earlier, for many thousands of years, we lived in fear and we expressed fear to each other. And that is a net result of certain thinking that does not have to exist. And it starts with you through the realization that you have the power, that you have access to this information. You can put it to the test. You can work with it. We made many videos on working with the imagination. And we can change our inner conversations, and we can observe as reality changes as a result of what we are infusing in our subconscious mind via our thinking, our imagination, and our inner conversations. And then what we'll find is that the subconscious mind, as a result of infusing the empowering information, will bring forth the definite chief aim in the most harmonious way. Ideas, hunches, inspirations, and actions will flow through you that would be related. He says, the prophet said, be ye imitators of God as dear children. How would I imitate God? Well, we are told that God calls things that are not seen as though they were seen, and the unseen becomes seen. So it's to believe. It's to speak in conviction. Watch the last video I did in which he had that conversation with his mentor, Abdullah. And understand what was discussed in there, and then you'll have a deeper understanding of how we imitate God and how to call things that are not seen as though they were seen, and the power of that. So speaking as it is so, number 17, reveals to us the thoughts, emotions, and actions that are related in vivid contrast, so we may evolve them into alignment with our definite chief aim to bring it forth. This is just one of the elements that explains what goes on. But there are infinite things that goes on that is the work of the sixth sense. One of the ways that I found is that by having a definite chief aim, I navigate reality, I speak, communicate, and live as if it was so, believe with firm conviction that it will be so, and then I could sense the feelings within, any emotions that come up that reveal to me misalignment. I observe my emotions, my thoughts, and my actions, and I ask myself, are they in alignment or are they not? Are they not? I will see the contrast with vividness, and then I will use something like the Robert Diltz model to evolve either the identity, the values and beliefs, the capabilities, the behaviors, and the environment to bring it forth, bringing yourself in alignment. James Allen says, man is made or unmade by himself. In the armory of thought, he forges the weapons by which he destroys himself. He also fashions the tools which he builds upon him for himself, heavenly mansions of joy and strength and peace. By the right thought and true application of thought, but by the right choice and true application of thought, man ascends to the divine perfection. By the abuse and wrong application of thought, he descends below the level of the beast. Between these two extremes are all grades of character, and man is their maker and master. So number 18, we have a choice. We can choose to live in our animalistic state, or we can ascend into higher spiritual beings living a human existence while commanding reality with our mind to transcend our limitations. Transcending the limitations is found by working via the sixth sense. This is the source of hunches and inspirations that guide you to work with elements that exist to bring forth your vision, or elements that don't exist to bring forth your vision. Number 19, fear-based thinking limits a person to see the possibilities to evolve within, which is the genesis of the evolution of the body and world that interacts with the body. So what I mean by this? If a person encourages thoughts of fear, they break their connection to the sixth sense. And as a result of it, they're unable to elevate their thoughts into a level that brings forth accordingly, because those thoughts are not impressing the subconscious mind with what it needs to work with the resources that it has via the five senses and the sixth sense to bring forth the results. Remember this, the subconscious is always going to bring forth what is impressed in the subconscious. And if there's fears and doubts surrounding what is impressed, it will bring that forth. Now, to evolve the body, to evolve the world, your body interacts with this world. Now, this is true even if you think about something as simple as hitting your fitness goal. If the thought is you see yourself and believe yourself to be a certain way, you will choose consciously to eat certain foods. You will choose consciously to prioritize your workouts. You will do it with conviction and faith, knowing that it's going to contribute. And you'll do it. That nobody needs to force you. The identity has been changed to be that of the self-image, of the vision of how you see yourself. But if you have fear surrounding or doubts surrounding your ability to create that, it will be brought forth in the very behaviors and the circumstances and the people and environments that will appear to hold you back from creating it. But you are creating that from the expressions via the subconscious. That applies to success, that applies to health and fitness, and everything else. He says, just as a gardener cultivates his plot, keeping it free from weeds and growing the flowers and fruits which he requires, so may a man tend to the garden of his mind, weeding out all the wrong, useless, and impure thoughts, and cultivating toward perfection the flowers and fruits of right, useful, and pure thoughts. By pursuing this process, a man sooner or later discovers that he is the master gardener of his soul, the director of his life. He also reveals within himself the laws of thought and understandings. Okay, so distinction, clearly, which is the premise of what we're talking about. He says he also reveals within himself the laws of thought and understands. This is within you, with ever increasing accuracy, how the thought forces and mind elements operate in shaping his character, circumstance, and destiny. So let me say that again. By pursuing this process, a man sooner or later discovers that he is the master gardener of his soul. You are the master gardener of your soul. It was not anyone else. It is you, the director of his life. He also reveals within himself the laws of thought and understands with ever-increasing accuracy how the thought forces and mind elements operate in the shaping of his character, circumstance, and destiny. So number 20, live in your imagination and navigate this world within to uncover any disempowering thoughts and replace them with empowering thoughts one by one. We have to cleanse what is within our subconscious mind that is bringing forth that what is not related to having the pure and uplifting thoughts that bring us into a state, elevate ourselves to a level where we work with the sixth sense to reveal the laws of thoughts with ever-increasing accuracy, how the thought forces and mind elements operate. That's how you will be revealed within how they operate, and you will understand. And then number 21, we came here to learn how to create using the power of our mind. And every moment is both an opportunity and a school for ever elevating our thinking. The question is this: do we understand fully, I mean really, that this moment is the acres of diamonds? There is no other acres of diamonds anywhere else. There was always the acres of diamonds where you are right now. And by following what is discussed in this video, you understand that your acres of diamonds is right here. You understand that you have the power to choose right now. You understand by making this choice and referencing back circumstance and situation and experiences in your life where you did value the acres of diamonds, that you were cultivating the mind. And you had cultivated it to the point where you brought forth. Now you can repeat this process again, again, and again. If you want to copy this mind map, the link is in the description. Thank you very much for watching. I'll talk to you soon. Take care.